युहंतः प्रविश्यमवाच मिमां प्रसुप्तां संजीवयत्यखिलशक्तिधरस्वधाम्नाम् अन्यांश्च हस्तचरणश्रवणत्वगादीन् प्राणान् नमो भगवते पुरुषाय तुभ्यं गुरुं हि स्वयं सत्यः प्रज्ञाभक्तिविनीतयः दीप्तिश्चाविभ्रता नित्यं तं गुरुं प्रणमाम्यहम् सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। पूर्वम् अस्माभिः शतश्लोकी ग्रन्थः अधीतः। शतश्लोक्याः अध्ययनेन पण्डितो भवति इति सूचयितुम् एकम् आभाणकमस्ति, शतश्लोकेन पण्डितः इति। ये तत्र अधीतवन्तः ये अनधीतवन्तश्च बहवः अत्र इदानीं सम्मिलिताः, सर्वेभ्यः शुभदिनेऽस्मिन् स्वागतं व्याहृत्य इतः परं यः ग्रन्थः अस्माभिः अध्येतुमिष्टः सः आरभ्यते। So we had a very long session of almost 82 hours reading this work, Shatashloki of Bhagavad Pada. Recently, I had an occasion to visit Theni, which is in South India. There, I went to meet Swami Omkarananda. Swami Omkarananda is a very, very special person. Rare to find the kind of combination that he has in his as intellectual accomplishments. He is a Vedadhyayi initially. Those who study Veda need not enter into Shastras. He is also a Shastradhyayi. And all the more surprising to me was his scholarship in Tamil literature too. So it's very rare to find such a combination. And that Swamiji, when I met him, so I was mentioning about the Shatashloki class, and he was asking, what next are you going to start? Then I said, it is not yet decided. Suddenly it struck to him that he should present a book to me and suggest that I could give a course on this text. So that is how the text Vedanta Muktavali was chosen. So it is just to give a background as to how we landed into this text. I was also not aware of the presence of this text itself. Of course, the author of this text, Bellamkonda Ramaraya, as he is called, was known to me by suddenly coming across another text. So, Shankara Shankara Bhashya Vimarshaha. So, that is another text which he has written. He is such a profound scholar. I was simply astonished when I went through this text. And that was completely unexpected. So somewhere I was just looking at some repository, and then this title attracted me, Shankara Shankara Bhashya Vimarshaha. That can be interpreted in two ways. So anyway, so that text interested me, and I studied a few pages of that text. And then when Swamiji said that Vedanta Muktavali is another work which has been authored by him, so I was quite amused to know this title also, Vedanta Muktavali. Usually the title Muktavali is associated to certain very important texts. Muktavali literally means pearls in the form of garland. Avali means a series of them. So strung. So, in the pearls strung in the form of a garland is Muktavali. We have a famous text which is called Siddhanta Muktavali, which is being studied by people who undertake the study of Nyaya Shastra. So, this Vedanta Muktavali, perhaps he titled it, keeping in mind that this should be as useful a text as Siddhanta Muktavali in the Nyaya Shastra when people want to study Vedanta Shastra. So perhaps that was the intention in giving the title of this text, Vedanta Muktavali. A few more things about this author before we get into the text. So this author is exceptionally brilliant author, and he has lived just about 130-140 years before. His birth took place in 1875 and he passed away in 1914, which means he hardly lived 39 years. The kind of accomplishments that he has done within this short span of life is simply striking to anyone who just glances through that. This text which Swamiji gave, so which some of you may be procuring a copy in a short while. So towards the end, they have listed the kind of works that he has authored. In Vedanta itself, he has authored almost a couple of dozens of work. And when it comes to Stotra, it is almost some 60-70 stotras which he has authored. It is almost like Shankara Bhagavad Pada authoring. So several dozens of stotras on various deities. So this is another aspect. So Shankara, Shankara, Bhashya, Vimarsha. So itself is a very big work. Vedanta Muktavali, as you can see. So this is the kind of volume that we have. So this volume is almost 620 pages. So almost 600 pages in this size. So this is another volume. And there are several such things that he has written in Advaita Vedanta. And in Dharma Shastra, he has written a few other things. Besides that, he has also composed several kavyas. So a couple of dozens of kavyas have been authored. So which amounts to almost 100 plus is the amount of works that he has authored. So this is simply amazing. And I don't think anyone who is other than someone who is really, really, really blessed by Ishvara can compose. This is not done by any normal individual. Around that time, we see that the end of 19th century and the beginning of 20th century. So here we find a stalwart, Bellankonda Ramaraya, and another person who is so famous and who took the fame of India across seashores is Vivekananda. And we have, of course, Ramanujam. There were several Jains who appeared around that period. So one of them is Bellankonda Ramaraya. So he is supposed to have hailed from a place called Bellankonda, which is close to Vishakhapatnam. There is yet another striking feature about this work, Vedanta Muktavali. He seems to have composed it within 1 month. So that is another thing which is really mind-boggling. So in the introduction which has been authored to an earlier edition of this text, so this text, Vedanta Muktavali, has been edited and published in Telugu Lipi. As he is from Andhra, he has written the entire text in Telugu Lipi only. So it is not that Devanagari has been employed by him. Even Vedanta Muktavali, which is a Sanskrit text, but it has been written in Telugu Lipi. So this has been the practice. So we used to write in Grantha Lipi, we used to write in Telugu Lipi, we used to write in various other lipis. And this has been initially published in 1949. And in that edition, so apparently in the introduction it is said that he has written this text starting with the Ashadha Masha. I'll just read that. I was quite surprised. It is saying, Virodhi Virodhikrit Ashadha Shukla Pratipadyarabdhoyam Granthaha आषाढ कृष्ण चतुर्दश्याम समाप्ति मगमत. सो विरोधी इज द नेम ऑफ द संवत्सरा. सो इट इज सेड विरोधी कृत. सो इट्स अ संवत्सरा आषाढ शुक्ल प्रतिपदी. It was commenced in Ashadha Shukla Pratipat. And it just got over. Ashadha Krishna Chaturdashyam Samapti Magamat. So this is the kind of speed at which he has composed this. So this work is essentially a beautiful summary of 12 Upanishads. It has been written in two parts, Purvardha and Uttarardha. Purvardha consists of 8 Upanishads and Uttarardha consists of 4 Upanishads. Normally we are familiar with Dashopanishad, but what he has done is to add 2 more Upanishads. They are the Kaivalya Upanishad and Shvetashvatara Upanishad. So he has included these 2 Upanishads. So Brihadaranyaka, Aitareya, Kaivalya and Shvetashvatara. So these 4 Upanishads form the part of Uttarardha. So the other 8 Upanishad, Ishakena Katha Prashna Munda Mandukya. So Tittarihi and Chandogyam. So this form the Purvardha. So this is what, in short, Vedanta Muktavali is. This Vedanta Muktavali is presented in the form of verses. When I say verses, it is all metrical composition. So metrical composition is not to be found in the Upanishad texts, at least the classical meters. Some of them may have this metrical form, but not the entire Upanishad. For instance, so the Upanishad which we will be commencing today, Ishavasya Upanishad. If you look at the Prathama Mantra, Ishavasya Midam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagat Yanjagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunjitha Magridharkasya Svithanam. This is of course a metrical composition. In a sense, this is Anushtup. You can see Ishavasya Midam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunjitha Magridharkasya Svithanam. So there will be some variations, but most of the verses follow a certain metrical pattern. What Vellankonda Ramaraya chose to compose this text was the Shardula Vikridita meter. Shardula Vikriditam is one of the beautiful meters which has 19 syllables per quarter. So we saw that Shatashloki was composed in Sragdhara, which had 21 syllables. The Shardula Vikriditam has 19 syllables. Before I commence this work, which has been composed entirely in Shardula Vikridita, and there are 790 verses together, both Purvardha and Uttarardha, if you see. So 790, 600 plus in the Purvardha, 300 plus in the Uttarardha. In fact, 366 happens to be the number in the Uttarardha, which means 624 in the Purvardha. So this is how the overall structure of the work is. When I was glancing through, I found the last verse, which is very interesting, 366th verse. So I will start with that, the last work of the text. Because the poet expresses himself the joy which he experienced at the completion of the work. And he also passes some very interesting message through that. And therefore, I thought of commencing our study with this work, which gives us a certain insight about how the work emerged. So therefore, we will read that verse first, which also gives something about the Kavi himself. So let me chant this verse, you can repeat, and then we will discuss the meaning of it. This was passed on to you through email. भारद्वाज सगोत्र राम कवि हृत।
भारद्वाज सगोत्र राम कवि हृत। भारद्वाज सगोत्र राम कवि हृत।
पद्मांतरस्थो हयग्रीवो राम मुखेन। पद्मांतरस्थो हयग्रीवो राम मुखेन। पद्मांतरस्थो हयग्रीवो राम मुखेन। सत्कृतिमिमां
सत्कृतिमिमां
सत्कृतिमिमां वेदांतमुक्तावलीं 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 कृत्वात्मीयगले निधाय
कृत्वात्मीयगले निधाय कृत्वात्मीयगले निधाय
मुदितोऽस्यापाङ्गमुक्तावलीं 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 आलक्ष्यात्मनि सङ्गतां प्रमुदितः
आलक्ष्यात्मनि सङ्गतां प्रमुदितः आलक्ष्यात्मनि सङ्गतां प्रमुदितः
रामः परं चाभवत् रामः परं चाभवत् रामः परं चाभवत्। दिस् वर्स् इस् अ वेरि वेरि ब्यूटिफुल् वर्स् विच् गिव्स् अस् अ ग्लिम्स् आफ् हौ ग्रेट् अ पोयट् हि वास्। सो देर् आर् लेयर्स् आफ् मीनिङ्ग्स् विच् वन् केन् फैण्ड् इन् दिस् वर्स्। Bharat, first thing that we notice is, so he comes from Bharadwaja Gotra. Okay. Bharadwaja Sagotra Ramakavihi. So Ramakavihi is how he describes. He is just Rama and he is also a Kavi. So Ramakavihi. So this word Kavi has various meanings which we will see, which is used even in Upanishad. कविर्म नीशी परिभू स्वयंभू इट डिस्क्राइब्स दैट ब्रह्मन इटसेल्फ। सो भारद्वाज सगोत्र राम कवि सो भारद्वाज सगोत्र राम कवि सगोत्र मीन्स समानम गोत्रम ओके समानम सो द गोत्र ऑफ दिस कवि इज सेम एज भारद्वाज। So sometimes when Pravara is said, so nowadays some people don't even know Pravara. So even Upanayana might have happened. But anyway, those who know Pravara, so they will say Bharadwaja Gotraha, Apastambha Sutraha, so Yetas Shakha Adhyayi, etc. So this is what people say. If we look at the tradition in Andhra, they will always use this word Sagotra. Sagotra. Samana. So there are some interesting jokes also. There are some interesting jokes with Sagotra also. See, they will say the Sagotra Vivaha is something which is supposed to be Nishiddha. Okay. Apparently one fellow did not know this. So in order to have some engagement somewhere, so he studied, so he is working, whatever it is, they said. So what is your Gotra? Same as your Gotra. So that is what this fellow apparently said. Anyway, so the Sagotra here basically, and the word Bharadwaja also, we should know. The word Bharadwaja, so since, in fact, when this verse was shared in email, so one of the members in the audience, the Honorable Justice, he sent a mail saying that there seems to be a couple of typos in this. And he also asked some grammatical peculiarities. So I will just highlight that. This word Bharadwaja itself, first of all, we should know. So Atreya Gotraha, Bharadvaja Gotraha is all generally people say. So Bharadvaja is the name of the Rishi. Okay? Bharadvaja is the name of the Rishi. For those who want to know little bit of Vyakarana. So from Bharadvaja stems the word Bharadvaja. Okay? Like from the word Raghu stems the word Raghava. From the word Vasudeva stems Vasudeva. So similarly, from Bharadvaja stems Bharadvaja. Okay? So this is how the word arrives. There is a suffix which is usually referred to as Anpratyaya. Okay? So this An. So this An, Bharadvaja plus An will give Bharadvaja. But then there is another special sutra which actually presents the derivation of the word Bharadvaja, which is to be seen in this verse. Okay, so that is something which may be of interest to some people who want to know a little bit of Vyakarana. So I'll just tell you. So this is just incidental. I may not get into much of Vyakarana, but so it may be good to know a couple of sutras. See, Rishyandhaka. Repeat.
Rishyandhaka. Rishyandhaka.
Vrishnikurubhyascha.
Vrishnikurubhyascha.
Vrishnikurubhyascha. Okay. Vrishnikurubhyascha. So there are four words here. Rishi, Andhaka, Vrishni and Kuru. Okay. So any of them, so if you want to describe, so those who come in that lineage, so you can use this, and you should use rather this Anpratyaya. So this is how it is. In fact, this is a Nishedhaka of Samaja Pratyaya, but we should just know this is a Rishi obviously. Okay. So Vasishtha, what will you say?
Vasishtha.
Vasishtha will become Vasishtha. Vishwamitra? It will be Vaishwamitra. Okay. So Vishwamitra will become Vaishwamitra. Here Bharadvaja has become Bharadvaja. What is happening is technically called as Adi Vriddhi. Vriddhi is a technical term. In Vyakarana Shastra, it means three letters. A, I, Au. In fact, Vyakarana Shastra, as written by Panini, commences with the definition of Vriddhi. Vriddhi Radaiche is the sutra. Okay. Now, as far as this sutra is concerned, it says, whenever it is Rishi Vachaka, you use this Anpratyaya. Okay. So, Kuru, when you want to say. So, Vrishni. So, you will have Vasudeva. Okay. Vrishnikula. So, Vasudeva. So, if you want to have Sahadeva, you will have Sahadeva. Nakula, Nakula. So, something like that. Now, this sutra gives you a way to obtain Bharadvaja. So Bharadvaja plus and Bharadvaja. But actually, what happens is there is another sutra which gives Anya Pratyaya. It is not An, but Anya. Okay. So this is actually there is a certain distinction which one can broadly bring about. This Anya Pratyaya basically tells you that Gotrotpanna means it is not directly from Bharadvaja. Okay, so not directly from him. So then you can use this. In fact, I will not get into the technical details of that right now. But this is how the word Bharadvaja comes. Bharadvaja Sagotra. So one who belongs to the Bharadvaja Gotra. Then what is the profession of this person? Kavihi, known as Kavi, Bharadvaja Sagotra, name is Rama. And then he says, हृत् पद्मांतरस्थः. So in the heart of this kavi, which is described as lotus, on this lotus came and sat who? Hayagrivaha. Hrit Padmantarastaha Hayagrivaha. Padmantarastaha, who is deeply rooted on that. So usually we describe heart as lotus. So in the lotus, the form of heart. So this person, who is this person? Hayagrivaha Devata. So he is a Hayagriva Upasaka. Hayagrivaha. He came and sat there. What did he do? He was prompting Rama. So whatever bhavana that arises actually makes us engage into activity, right? So suppose I say, I like you so much. So a deeper expression and a stronger expression will be, I love you by my heart. You understand? So this Hrit Padmantarasthaha. So in the heart, this person is sitting. And this person gives the impulse, necessary impulse for Rama Kavi. So that is what is being described here. Rama Mukhena Sat. So this work is described as Satkritihi. The Satkritihi can be understood in two ways. How do you understand? Satkritihi is Sadvishaini Kritihi Satkritihi. So suppose you say this. When you say Sadvishaini, the Sat here refers to Sadeva Somvedam Agre Asid Brahman. Okay? So this is something which has to do with that Brahman. Okay? Sat Kritimimam Vedanta Muktavalim. The other normal meaning of Sat Kriti is Shobhana Kritihi Sat Kritihi. When you say, he is doing lot of satkarya. So what is satkarya? So shobhanam. So that which will bring in welfare. Okay? That which will bring in happiness. So then you use the word satkarya. Satpurusha, when we say. So in various contexts, we normally use the word sat to refer to something which is pleasant, something which is beneficial, something which is acceptable. So this is how we normally use the word Sat. So in that sense, you can use the word Satkriti to describe as a beautiful composition. The other thing is referring to the subject matter itself, something which is pertaining, a Kriti which pertains to describe the word Sat. Om Tat Saditi Nirdeshaha Brahmanas Trividhas Smritaha. Om Tat Sat, all of them refer to that Brahman. So that way also Sat Kriti Mimam. What is it titled? Vedanta Muktavali. Why does he call it Vedanta Muktavali? So Vedanta, if you try to break the word, so Vedanta is a term that is used to refer to Upanishads. So Upanishad is referred to as Vedanta. Why is it described Vedanta? Because it appears at the end of the Veda. So take this Taittiriya Upanishad. It appears at the end of the Brahmana Bhaga. Take Ishavasya Upanishad, so which we are going to study. It is the last chapter of this Samhita. Okay, Shukla Yajurveda Samhita. Okay. So this is how it appears. So based on where it is available in the Vedic corpus, you give the name Vedanta. Okay? So that is one way of understanding. The other way of understanding is that which is something which has to be studied towards the end of the study of Vedas. So that we will see little later. Anyway, so it basically refers to Upanishads. And Muktavali, as we saw, the term literally means the pearl in the form of a garland, necklace, a pearl necklace. So Vedanta Muktavali, what does it mean? It refers to the subject matter found in the Upanishads present in the form of a beautiful necklace of pearls. Okay, so that is what we need to understand from the title. So Vedanta Muktavali. So who prompted this? Hayagrivaha. So sitting in the heart of Ramakavi, Rama Mukhena. This also incidentally tells us how we should visualize, understand our own acts. So if something good happens, then you should try to shift it, Ishvara Anugraha. So it was his blessing, it happened. So therefore he says, Hayagrivaha Rama Mukhena. So keeping Rama as an instrument, he built this necklace. Okay. Who? Hayagriva himself. So Hayagriva, keeping Rama as an instrument, constructed this beautiful pearl of necklace, which describes the content of the Upanishads. So this is what he says in the first half of the verse. Hayagrivo Rama Mukhe na Satkriti Mimam Vedanta Muktavali. Normally, people give hint. Great poets give hint somewhere in the text, either at the beginning or at the end, how to describe this title. So if you look at Leelavati, so Leelavati would have been integrated by Bhaskaracharya in his own text. That is how Arya Bhatastviha Nigadati. So similarly you will find, okay. So some authors, they try to give a hint of the name of the text itself somewhere in the beginning or at the end. So keeping that style, he says this. Having said that, he further says, Kritva. Kritva means who? Kritva? Hayagrivaha. So he is the person who authored. Okay? So not the Ramakavi. Hayagrivaha Kritva. What did Hayagriva do then? Atmiya Gale Nidhaya. So Hayagriva himself found this necklace very beautiful. So he wanted to wear it. Atmiya Gale Nidhaya. This is a poetic way of expressing. Okay? So Hayagriva was really thrilled to look at this, and then he immediately started wearing it. And having worn that necklace, so he was so joyous. And therefore, so now the poet says, the rays that were emanating from his eyes. Okay. So when you are really happy, so others would also like to see your eyes. When you are otherwise, the other also has to shut his eyes. Right? So here the poet says, the Hayagriva was immensely pleased, and because of that the joy started flowing out of his eyes. Muditaha Asya Apanga Muktavalim Alakshya Atmani Sangatam Pramuditaha. So Apanga Muktavali basically means, the glances are described usually as Apanga. Okay? So Apanga Leela is a famous phrase. So this Apanga Muktavali, so that Vedanta Muktavali, and then we find this Apanga Muktavali. So that Vedanta Muktavali was worn by Hayagriva, and what comes out of Hayagriva is Apanga Muktavali, which is what this author seeks for. Okay, so he wants the Apanga Muktavali, and this Apanga Muktavali made him immensely pleased, Ramakavi. So once this Apanga Muktavali fell upon him and started, okay, becoming a garland upon him, Alakshya Atmani Sangatam. Atmani Sangatam means So something which was directed towards him. Atmani sangatam, alakshya atmani sangatam, pramudita ramah parancha bhavat. The word ramah parancha bhavat can be understood in two ways. Ramaha param bhavat means, so param brahma means he himself became param. So this is one way. See, when you are joyous, that is all, you become one with that Brahman. Okay, ramah parancha bhavat. The other way to see is param pramuditaha bhavat. Okay, he became extremely joyous. Okay, so when the kataksha of Hayagriva fell upon him and that became a garland around him, so he became extremely joyous. So this is how he basically expresses his joy towards the end of the completion of Vedanta Muktavali. Okay. This Vedanta Muktavali is the name of the verses which have been composed. And this is accompanied by a commentary. This commentary has been titled Dinakara. Okay. So that is also a very interesting thing. The title of the commentary is Dinakara. Some of those who are familiar with this Nyaya Shastra tradition, so they would know that the Siddhanta Muktavali has a commentary which is described as Dinakari. And here he describes this as Dinakara. Dinakara literally means sun. Okay, so Dinakara means sun. So what will moon be described as?
Nishakara.
So Nishakara. So if you say Nishachara, so Nishakara is moon. Tam Nishachara Vinashakaram Namami. There is a stotra. Nishachara Vinashakaram Namami. Anyway, so Nishakara is moon. Dinakara is sun. There is another verse which has been composed by Ramaraya himself before he set forth to write this commentary, which he describes rightly as Dinakara. Why do I say rightly? So once we start reading the commentary, we will be convinced. So this Dinakara is someone who sheds light. Right? Without the light from Dinakara, nothing will happen. Okay? So he is the source of energy. He is the source of light. Now, the poet, having composed this Muktavali, he felt that it may be a good idea to write one's own commentary. So there was some impulse in him. And there he expresses his thought, what made him write. In a sense, this will be extremely useful because what the poet has in his mind will be in a nutshell conveyed through his own auto-commentary. Of course, one can build upon that. All that one has in mind cannot also be conveyed, but the gist can be precisely conveyed. So that is what seems to have happened. And there is a beautiful verse. Let me read this and you can repeat. So that verse was composed in Shardula Vikridita meter, as I told you, all the 790 verses. This doesn't form a part of Vedanta Muktavali, mind you. So this verse which I am going to say, this is in Vasanta Tilaka. It has 14 syllable meter. Kanthasthitadinakare satisau amartham.
Kanthasthitadinakare
satisau amartham. Kanthasthitadinakare satisau amartham. Muktavali kalayate natu kevaleti.
Muktavali kalayate natu kevaleti.
Muktavali kalayate na duke valeti.
मुक्तावलीं कृतवता तुरगाधिराज मुक्तावलीं कृतवता तुरगाधिराज मुक्तावलीं कृतवता तुरगाधिराज कारुण्यतो दिनकरः क्रियते मयासौ कारुण्यतो दिनकरः क्रियते मयासौ कारुण्यतो दिनकरः क्रियते मयासौ
एतदर्श प्रतिज्ञा मया असौ दिनकरः क्रियते So there is a lot of fun in this verse also. So here, Dinakaraha means sun. Dinakaraha refers to this commentary. There are four words which are to be understood in two senses. So that is how Shlesha is generally composed. The Shlesha is a beautiful alankara. As he is a poet, he brilliantly brings out an example of Shlesha.
कंठस्थितादिनगरे सति सौवमर्थं मुक्तावली कलयते न तु केवलेति
केवला मुक्तावली मीन्स मुक्तावली ऑन इट्स ओन बाय इट्स मियर प्रेजेंस सो दिस व्हाट वी नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड सो केवला मुक्तावली मीन्स Muktavali by its mere presence,
Sauvamartham nakalayate kanthasthita.
See, so we have to see, Dinakare, so here, Dinakara refers to sun in the first half of the verse. The first quarter, the word Dinakara refers to sun. What the poet tries to convey here is, Suppose you have the most costliest pearl, okay? Assume. So there are a variety of pearls which will be so attractive and glittering. When will it be? Only when there is light shedding upon it. You understand? If no light is there, so whether it is a Muktavali or it is a Ratnavali, Okay, or a diamond avali, none of them will glitter. Okay, so this is what he is trying to convey. Now see the Shlesha. The Shlesha here is Kanthasthita means that which is worn on the neck. Kanthastha means which has been memorized. You understand? So Kanthasthita Muktavali means So I am so good at memorizing. I have memorized all the verses. Tell me meaning of one verse. So nothing will come out. Okay. So there was I remember about 35 years ago, close to 35 or 40 years ago, I used to attend whenever there was a break in the college. Yeah, something like that. Okay. Or school. So, Sanskrit college was next to my compound, my house. So, I had a passion to study Sanskrit. But my father said, you study regularly in the school. So, anyway, so that is what happened. So, when there is a break, so and suppose there is no class, I come little early. And there was another pandit who used to teach Vyakarana. I wanted to study, so whenever I see the Vakyatha in Vyakarana, I will be so thrilled. When will I be able to do this kind of Vyakarana? So that is what I was thinking. But anyway, that may not happen in this Janma. So anyway, the point is, so why I am saying is, I am just reminded of interesting phrase that teacher was using. So he was saying, so, Nirakshara Kukshi. Okay. So, Nirakshara Kukshi. So, sometimes in Tamil he will say, see, so Vayatha Kicha Kuda or Akshara Adukka Mudiyadhu. So, it is some way of expressing. So, they will just rote memorization doesn't help. So, keeping that in mind, the poet says, Kanthasthita Muktavali.
So the important phrase here is sauvamartham. So sauvamartham. So dinakare. So only when dinakara is there, as the pearl will reflect and really be charming to your eyes, so too this Vedanta Muktavali, when accompanied by this dinakara, so will be extremely charming. So this is what overall he wants to convey. How does he use the word sauvamartham? So this was a little puzzling to me when I initially read this. So the sauvamartham is a interesting compound. The word sauvam seems to be occurring in the Upanishadic literature. Vajasaneyi Samhita also has this word sauvam. So it seems to be stemming from sva, and then there is a pratyaya which is anpratyaya. So earlier we saw this Bharadvajaha either through anpratyaya. This anpratyaya is used in several senses. I will spend a couple of minutes to explain that to you. The sauvam means sva plus an. Normally, so when we want to describe this ruk or this mantra belongs to Indra, what we will say? Aindram is what we will say. Aindram, Gayatram. So this is what we generally say. Similarly, suppose we want to say, so what happens is, as I indicated in the term Bharadvaja itself, there is a vriddhi which will happen. Vriddhi refers to A, I, Au. Okay, these three letters. Now here what we see is Sau. So there is a vriddhi which seems to have happened here. But did it happen or something else happened to give this form is what we need to understand. So vriddhi is actually, there should be a certain vowel and the sthana has to be there. When it is a samana sthana, you will have, suppose I have Bharadvaja, so you have A. And A is something which is similar to that, so therefore vriddhi. If you have E, Indra, it will become I Indra. So if you have U, then it will become Au. But you don't have U here. All that you have is Sva. Sva is the word that we have. Okay. In fact, there is a very interesting sutra. Let me ask so this question. So there is a student here who has studied Vyakarana. Now we have the word Vayakarana. How does it appear? This Vayakarana is a word which we have. How? You don't have. So either you should say V, then Akarana. Okay, let us say V Akarana. Then something should happen. Okay. For that there is a sutra. In fact, to explain this, there is an interesting sutra. I'll just tell that. So those who want to pursue little more deeper study, you can think about it. So the sutra is naivabhyam na yiv yivabhyam yakara vakarabhyam ityartha. Okay. Na yivabhyam padantabhyam पूर्वौतु ताभ्यामौच ताभ्याम ऐच. ओके, ऐच मीन्स एवं अयौच. ओके, सो व्हाट डस दिस सूत्र से नैवाभ्याम पदांताभ्याम पूर्वौतु ताभ्यामैच. दिस इज 733 इन पाणिनी सूत्र. इट बेसिकली टेल्स यू दैट इफ अ वर्ड एंड्स विद यकारा और वकारा. So, na vriddhihi, this is what you have to understand. So, vriddhi doesn't happen. Vriddhi doesn't happen, but what happens is, this I and au come as an agama. No, agama. So, it just comes in. Okay, so this is an agama. Aich. So if it is yakara, then something will happen. If it is vakara, something will happen. If it is yakara, I will come. That is how you get the word vayakarana. If it is vakara, so you will have au. Okay, so this is something which you have to keep in mind. But that sutra doesn't actually help here, because it says padantabhyam. Okay, so only under the condition if it is a padanta, so then you will have this I and au appearing, okay, as an agama. So that will give the necessary form. But here we don't have a padanta. So here we have sva. Sva is just padanta, there is no va. Padanta, there is only a. What you have to understand is, this in vayakarana, what happens is, be will happen. So then something will happen. Okay, I will not get into that now. Simply sauva, let me explain. So we have sva. So what we have is is, v, a. These are the three letters that are there. Is, v, a. Okay, these three. So in order to consider a few such cases, so there is another sutra which has been introduced by Panini just after this sutra, 734. He says, dvaradinancha. Repeat.
Dvaradinancha. Dvaradinancha.
He lists a certain number of words starting with dvara. Okay. Dvara swar vyalkasha swasti swara. Swadu, mrudu, and so on. So all of them have been listed here. And for these words, so I and au come as an adesha. And therefore what happens here is, so in the word sva, okay, which has been listed in this guru, so this au adesha comes, and therefore we have the form sauva. Okay, and when will it happen? It will happen only when the pratyaya, okay, an, any, so in fact it will be technically called as nyiti, nyiti, kiti pare. Okay, when a pratyaya which has na at its end, nya at its end, or ka at its end, okay, so then you will have this. So this is how the word sauva comes. Okay. The sauva is a very interesting phrase which he has used. It can be used in two senses. One is, in fact, there was a question. So how will we have the word? I want to say that this can be interpreted in two ways. One is swasambandhi. Okay, that which is connected with this. So, sauvam artham means this muktavali, you have to understand. The text muktavali will not present the fullest form of what it contains without this dhanakara. You understand? Sauvam artham means the meaning which is there inside cannot be fully understood without this dhanakara. Okay, that is what he wants to convey. So, as the pearl will not, okay, show its beauty without dhanakara, so to sauvam artham, okay, the treasure which is contained in this. This is one way of understanding. Another way of seeing this is, this word swar refers to swarga. So we have this famous verse, yenna dukhena sambhinnam nachagrastam anantaram abhilashopa neetancha tatsukham swafpadaspadam. Okay. Swafpada aspadam means, whenever we say, ah, it was a heaven, what do you mean? You don't know what heaven is. You don't know what hell is. But we use the phrases. So, it basically tells you that it is something which presents you an enormous amount of joy. You dwell in the joyous world. Okay. So, that is where you use this word, swarga. So that is what is nicely conveyed. Yen nadukhena sambhinnam nachagrastam anantaram abhilashopanitancha tatsukham swafpadaspadam. Now, sauvamartham means, so this swar is also listed in this dvara, dvaradi. So when I said the sutra, dvaradi nanche, first word is dvara, next word is swar. Swar is there and sva is also there. So in which case, so what happens is this sauvam, so is swarge bhavam, that is how you get the meaning. Okay, swarge bhavam, in that sense after swar and comes, and this is how the rupa gets formed. Now the sauvam artham, so when we take that meaning, okay, so this muktavali, this real happiness, so this purpose of this Vedanta is, Vedanta muktavali is to enlighten you and take you to the state in which you will dwell in happiness. The dwelling in happiness may not happen to the full extent unless this Dinakara is available for you. Okay, so it is in that sense he uses this word sauvamartham. So here let us read this verse once more. Kanthasthita dinakare sati sauvamartham muktavali kalayate natu kevaleti. Okay. So dinakare sati kalayate, only when sun is present, it presents its beauty and charm. Otherwise, no. Similarly, muktavalim kritavata turagadhiraja karunyato dinakarah kriyate mayaso. Similarly, having composed this muktavali, now I set forth myself to write this dinakara. And once again, he uses this phrase, turagadhiraja karunyataha. Okay, by the sheer blessing of this Hayagriva. Turagadhiraja karunyato dinakarah kriyate mayasau. So having composed this verse, this Bellankonda Ramaraja has started composing this commentary which is called Dinakara. So there is a beautiful, so Kanthasthita has two meanings. So Dinakara has two meanings. The word Sauvamartham has also two meanings. So all these words which have been employed in this verse have double meaning. And therefore, this Muktavali also has two meanings. Right? So that way, this verse is a very beautiful verse which forms an example of this Shlesha Alankara. Okay? So that is how poets compose. Now let me very quickly read the first verse here, and then we will continue the details of that in the next class. Ishavasya Upanishad. So Ishavasya Midam Samasta Bhuvanam.
Ishavasya Midam Samasta Bhuvanam. ईशावास्यमिदं समस्त भुवनं
त्यक्त्वार्थगेहादिकं ब्रह्मण्येव मुमुक्षुणानवरतम्
ब्रह्मण्येव मुमुक्षुणानवरतम्
निष्ठाविधेयात्मनि अर्हत्वाय च तत्र कर्म विहितम् कार्यं पुरा निष्फलम् कार्यं पुरा निष्फलम् विद्वानित्थमुपाचरन् हि भजते निर्लेप आत्मेश्वरम्
nirlepa atmeshwaram nirlepa atmeshwaram.
Basically, this verse paraphrases the content of the first two mantras of the Ishavasya Upanishad. Ishavasya Upanishad in all consists of 18 mantras. It is a short Upanishad, very short Upanishad, consists of 18 mantras. The first two mantras are in fact considered to be conveying the essence of Upanishad by great brilliant minds. In fact, we will see that in great detail. It just goes like this in Saswara if you want to hear. Ishavasya midag sarvangyat kincha jagatyan jagat tena tyaktena bhunjitha nagrudharkasya svittham kurvan nebeha karmani jiji vishechhatag samaha evan dvayi nanyathe tostina karma lipyate nare. This is how the mantra goes. And this Upanishad has this Shanti Mantra, which is very famous Shanti Mantra. So, we will end this class with that. There are very interesting discussions which have been presented by Bellankonda in the commentary Dinakara here. There is a very interesting discussion. Those of you who have had some exposure to Vedanta and who have studied this Adhyasa Bhashya can perhaps read that once, then you will be able to see how he brilliantly brings in various kinds of arguments which generally arise in someone who wants to undertake the study of Vedanta. What is the purpose? Does it serve any purpose at all, or is it a meaningless pursuit, and so on and so forth. So all these questions are being answered by him before he gets into the explanation of this mantra in the Dinakara, okay, in the commentary. So, we will read the commentary also. I was quite pleased to see the style in which he has presented. So, we will do that in the next class. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. सर्वे सुखिनः सन्तु सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत्. ॐ